Amen.
And I want to say it's a blessing to have everybody. Blessed to see Minister Larry. Amen. Blessing to have you this morning with us. And each and every one of you. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And thank God for the testimony. Amen. There is power. The Bible said in Acts that when we receive the Holy Ghost, we shall receive power.
Amen.
Amen. So we do have authority. Amen. Jesus spoke to the storm, and then Proverbs talk about how that the power of life and death is in your tongue.
Yes.
Amen. So it's good to know that you have authority. Then you don't sit around and let the devil rule your life. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. That means you can take authority over him, whether sickness and disease, or whether poverty, fear, anxiety, stress. Amen. We don't have to live that way. I tell you what, I said, let's go to Ephesians chapter 2, but I just feel the nudge in my spirit to go somewhere else.
All right.
So let's go back to Hebrews chapter 4. Amen. I feel led this morning to just, God just went off in tongues and the Holy Spirit spoke. And some of y'all may not understand that, but you got to be led by the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Amen. You can't get up and just do it the way you want to do it. Amen. You got to do it the way the Holy Spirit directs you to do it. Amen.
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 Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah. And again, we're gonna just briefly talk about, I guess we're going to finish talking about entering the rest of God. Amen. And I just want to say this. Of course, we know in Genesis that when God got through creating the heavens and the earth, amen, and everything that was in it, and every tree bearing seed, amen, and after he created the garden, the Bible said he placed Adam in it, and he told Adam to manage it, amen. That was his job, to manage the garden, amen, to make sure, really, if I can say it like this, it was his job to keep the serpent out. It was his job to keep the enemy out, you know, but when the woman, his wife, persuaded him to eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, then the Bible said that both of their eyes was open, and they knew that they was naked.
All right.
Meaning that, amen, their perception is switched from the spirit to the physical senses. Where they became aware of what was going on around about them.
All right.
Because it's obvious that they had to be walking in the spirit. This is just common sense. It's obvious, according to the scripture, that they wasn't aware of their physical body, of themselves being naked. So they was walking in the spirit. And it is amazing to me how that you can have a physical body and not know it's naked. But when they ate up the tree of knowledge and good and evil, the Bible said their eyes opened. And they knew. They became aware. They became conscious. They knew that they were naked. So, in the beginning, Adam was just walking in such great fellowship with God. He was so connected to the spirit realm. And that's kind of hard to perceive, but isn't it amazing that you don't know you're physically naked, but you notice the animals and everything else around about you? It's something to know. It's a mystery in there. That's what I'm trying to figure out. Because the Bible said that they didn't. God said, "Who told you you was naked?"
All right.
I didn't give you that knowledge. That's right. I didn't make you aware. Right. You. And so that tells me that they was not walking in their five senses, but they was walking in the spirit. Mm-hmm. And we got to get refocused. Can I say that? We got to get refocused as born-again believers where we walk. The Bible says we walk by faith. Amen. 2 Corinthians 5 and 7 says we walk by faith and not by sight.
All right.
Not by what we can see. Not by what we feel. Not by what we touch. What's happening to the church is this. Is we're walking by what God was talking every single day. Even the scripture said in Genesis 3, it talks about that, how that the voice of God walked through the garden. And when God showed up, Adam knew it. Adam saw the voice of God. He heard the voice of God walking through the garden. And I feel like what God is saying this morning is that he wants us to get back to a place where we're walking in fellowship, where we're walking in oneness with him. Basically, that's what it was.
Jesus.
Adam was walking in such fellowship with God that not only did he hear it, but he saw it. Y'all don't get it. Amen. He saw the voice of God. We know God is his word, right? In the beginning was the word was with God, and the word was God. But Adam saw the word of God walking through the garden. In the cool of the day. So when God wanted fellowship, instead of, well, my goodness, my God. The words of God walked through the garden. Isn't that something? God's word walked through the garden, and it's obvious to me that his word found him. I always said this. I said, knowledge carries what? Knowledge carries purpose, destiny, and character. So whenever God speaks a word over your life, he changes you. He changes your character. He changes your nature. Amen. He changes you. And so when God sends his word, that means that God himself came down in the form of his word. Because how many know that we can't handle God? If he came down in his original form. Amen. Jesus was the word made flesh. But he really wasn't God in the fullness of his glory. But he was the glory as of the only begotten Son of God. He was the glory as of the only begotten Son of God. He was God's glory in flesh. He was the character of God, tabernacle in human flesh. And that's what we're supposed to be. We're supposed to be the word made flesh.
All right.
Now, I don't supposed to be going that way, but my point is this. Not only did God talk to Adam, God also provided everything that Adam needed. On the sixth day, God worked 5 days, 6 days, and on the seventh day, God rested. And when God rests, everything was finished. The Bible said he looked and he said, it may say everything I made, and I'm just third time. God said it was good and very good. And then not only that, God spoke the blessing over Adam. He said, multiply and increase the earth. God spoke the blessing. What did the word blessing mean? The word blessing means to speak an end to a thing. How do you know that God has, and for our life, I'm trying to get you to hear something this morning, that God has already spoken our end.
All right.
Amen.
You know what? And that's a part of entering the rest of God.
All right.
Is that the end has already been spoken. All we have to do is enter into what has already been finished. When we said this, we got to enter into the seventh day, the day of rest, the day where everything is complete, where everything is finished. All we got to do is enter into it. God has completed it.
Yes.
Did y'all know that the word Eden, the Garden of Eden, the word Eden is translated a place of pleasure, a place of peace. So when God created the garden, he put gold, he put diamonds, he put everything in there, all the resources that Adam would need. But except the difference, you know, in this time, we got that kind of money. We're going shopping, we're buying houses, we're buying cars, we're buying that. But he didn't need it for that purpose. He put all those beautiful diamonds, sapphires, and all those things in the earth, I tell you, everything we needed is already provided. But we got to receive it. And I said this a few services ago. God spoke to me, sitting in service, and I'm going to read this scripture in just a minute. But God said to me, sitting in service, he said, son, he said, faith is entering the seventh day.
Jesus.
Faith is receiving everything that God has already fixed for you. You know, I'll never forget this. I think I was around there, it might have been New Beginnings. I was sitting there praying one day, and God said to me, he said this to me, and to me it was deep to me, and it kind of blew my mind, and I said to myself, God said, you ain't asking me to create nothing. He said, you don't have to. He said, actually, Victor, when you pray, and you release, and this is why he showed me in a vision. He said, when you pray, and then he said, when he tells Jeremiah in Jeremiah 1, he said, I hasten to fulfill my word, didn't he? And then you go to Isaiah 55. Talks about, he said, like the rain and come down from the earth and waters the earth. He said, so shall my word be that come out of my mouth. You know, he talked about how that is going to accomplish what he said. But God said to me when I pray, he said, son, do you know when you pray, you release the words into the atmosphere? And it's like in a vision. God showed me my prayers going up from the earth. But he showed me the angels assigning my words to the people that was going to bring the past what I prayed.
Jesus.
And he said to me, he said, you praying, but you ain't creating nothing. When you're praying, you're giving me something to fulfill, to release. And then he said, and sometimes that his angels, that they hasten to fulfill his word. So when we pray, when we speak the word of God, part of us receiving the blessing of God is that we got to speak, we got to pray. And prayer is just dialogue. You talking to God, giving God back his word. Not telling God what you think, how you feel. Prayer ain't got nothing to do with how you feel and what you think. Prayer got everything to do with the word of God. When you pray God's word, then God is obligated to fill in his word. God loves us. And the Bible says Jesus has been touched by the feeling of our infirmities. He know what it's like to be tempted. He know what it's like, amen, to go through trials, but he never failed. He never failed a test. He never failed a trial. And so he gave us the Holy Spirit to help us, to empower us, to help us that when we're going through life, we don't have to fail.
Jesus, thank you, Lord.
But we can overcome. We can overcome. Because greater is what? He that is in you than he that's where? That's in the world.
That's right.
So we have the greater one on the inside. And so God said to me, he said, you speak the word. Mm-hmm. You release my word. And I'll fulfill it. And he showed me that vision. Now, never forget, he just showed me, he said, when you release it, he said, the angels take your words. Because if God's not creating anything anymore, then God has to assign the coming to pass of your prayer to the heart of a person.
Yes, yes, Lord.
And I said to God, I said, God, I need to pray more. I need to stay in your face more. I need to be on my knees more. I need to be speaking this word more. Because really, in prayer, you're calling those things which be not as though they were. Even though you don't possess them, you're calling them into your life, into existence, to manifest, amen, in your life. You're not really creating. You're really calling it into you. You're calling it in, amen, into your life. Amen, into your life you call it. And so every morning I get up and I say, Father, I thank you that every need is already met.
Yes.
Sometimes I go to the park and I begin to pray for the nation and pray for this city. Amen. And just walk around the park just praying and confessing and speaking the word. And I'm saying, God, I'm expecting you to bring it to pass. I'm expecting the angels to bring it to pass to fulfill every word that I speak. And even in prayer, I hear this. When we pray, we still have to rest. Somebody said, what you mean? You got to rest. You got to know that God has already heard you. talking about when you pray, believe that you receive it when you pray.
That's right.
Not when you get it in your hands, but when you pray, first you got to receive it on the inside, amen? You don't receive it on the outside first, Brenda. You receive it on the inside.
That's right.
And when you receive it on the inside, you ought to be praising God in advance. And Father God, I thank you that you, like Jesus said, he said, Father, I thank you that you always hear me.
Yes. Yes, Lord.
And I mean, because of the sacrifice and the blood of Jesus, God always hears us.
Yes.
That's why the Bible said we can come to the throne of grace in the times of trouble. We can come to the throne of grace in the times of trouble to find, to get help. It actually said to find grace in the times of need. You mean tell me you can come and get some more grace, some more favor? So God want to hear us. God want to answer. But we got to believe that we receive.
Yes,
see, we can't be an effective church if we're walking in unbelief. We can't be an effective people if we're walking in doubt. We got to believe that we receive it when we pray, not when we get it.
Yes.
And some of us, we don't want to dance till we got it in our hands. You know what, Brother Jeremy? You got to act like you're already healed before it comes into your body.
Right.
You got to already say, Lord, I thank you. I'm already healed. Amen. If you, whatever you believe in God for in your life, whether it's a husband, whether it's a house, whether it's a car, whatever you want for your, what you believe in God for at that time, you got to pray and believe that you receive it. And the next thing you got to do is just begin to worship. Enter the rest of God and just begin to worship. Relax. Quit trying to make it happen. Quit, amen. And just begin to worship him in advance.
Yes, Lord Jesus.
Let me say this. About a week ago, I was just praying this prayer. I said, Lord, you got to move somebody out of that building so I can get up there now. I'm telling you the truth. I said, I don't know what care where you sent them, but we need somewhere we can come and worship.
All right.
And I did. And I was praying in my heart. And I started speaking the word. I said, Lord, I thank you that you're going to give us somewhere where we can have service and Bible study and really get into the word of God the way we need to. And I began to worship him and just praise him. And then I didn't pray no more about it. And then yesterday morning, the guy called me at 7 o'clock in the morning. He said, I just found your number. At 7 o'clock, can you come up here? I'm thinking to myself, I just got out from work. I don't want to, you know, but I came on. I said, yeah, let me put my shoes on. I better come on now. And so I came up, and we sitting here and talked. And he told me, he said, guess what? He said, you can get the building. He said, it's $500 a month. He said, I pay the light bill and the water bill and everything. Amen. He said, you ain't got to give me all. I don't need a deposit. All I need is the first month rent, and you can go in. And he said, all you got to do is let me know when you get ready to go. Just tell me so I can prepare somebody else to come in. That's the blessing of God. That's the favor of God. Because most people would have been talking to you, amen, amen. They want that deposit. They want that money. But I rested in God and trusted that the Lord was going to provide. You know, and what I'm saying to you this morning is this, that when God created Adam and when God finished the garden, the 7 days, the Bible said that God rested. Mm-hmm. The scripture said he ceased from his labor. He didn't work no more. Everything was finished. So God said to me, faith is entering the rest of God, and faith sees everything already finished. It's already done. So if something is already done, what you got to do? Just worship it. See, yeah, I hear it in my spirit. See, we spend time with our wives and our children and different ones, we worry about them all day long, praying, oh Lord, oh God, deliver him, Lord, I see him. Don't be like Job. The Bible said that Job was afraid that Job offered sacrifices all day long because he was afraid that his children were sinning against God.
Jesus.
And you know what the Bible said? The thing that he feared the most came upon him. Mm-hmm. Because what he was doing was not in faith. It was in fear. And fear works the opposite of faith.
Yeah.
Where faith will bring forth the word of God work by love, but the fear will bring forth. It has, I can say the same in a sense, it has the ability to bring forth what you're afraid of. So what am I saying to you? To enter the rest of God, so guess what, Drinda? I thank you that Bethany saved.
Amen.
I thank you that Bethany delivered. And you know what? Then you leave it in the hand of God. And every chance you get and every morning you get up, you ought to say, God, I thank you, my sons are already saved. Now, I'm not gonna sit around here and worry about it. All I'm gonna do is thank you in advance that they are already delivered. If you really believe that you receive it when you pray, then faith says you act like it's already done.
All right.
Father God, I thank you.
Thank you, Lord.
I thank you for my new house. I thank you for my new car. I thank you for my new building, God, where we're going to be able to feed the hungry and clothe the naked and do the things that you called us to take the gospel to the nations, God. I thank you in advance, Father God. So I'm not going to spend all day, amen, travailing and tired, but I'm going to thank him in advance that it's already done. I'm going to speak the word and I'm going to rest.
Yes.
Now, he did say you can put him in remembrance of his word. Sometimes I give him and say, Father God, I thank you in advance. I thank you for deliverance. I thank you for salvation.
All right.
I thank you that Faith International Ministry, amen, it's going to increase.
Amen.
I prophesied over this house.
Amen.
That God is going to increase this house. I prophesy over this house that God is going to take us to the nation. I prophesy over this house that God is going to save our children. He's going to save our grandchildren. Amen. They're going to be delivered and they're going to serve the Lord. And I rest in it.
Yes.
Somebody asked me how much you, how you serve them? They save, sanctify, and filled with the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Now you can say something else, that's up to you. But that's the way you ought to talk in faith. You ought to talk like it's already done. And see, that's the problem, that when you deal with the five senses, you're dealing with reality, what is. But faith is beyond the natural, it ain't got nothing to do with it. We spend too much time dealing with time instead of eternity.
All right.
John, Joey already delivered. Leave it alone and thank God for it. You spend too much time worrying about it. That ain't your job. You ain't God. You can't fix her. You need to put in the hand of God and leave her alone.
Yes.
Amen.
You spend too much energy trying to fix her. And you will never be God. And that's what we got to understand. We're not God, but we're his children. It's God. God. The Bible said he ain't to fulfill his word. He's a victory.
That's right.
The one? Your kids, your family, your husband. And then you got to already see them deliver. And it ain't LaWanna's job to go out there and make them get saved. It's LaWanna's job to pray and let God deliver them.
That's right. Amen.
Do you know we run folks out of church because we trying to fix them to be God? But faith says, I pray, I believe that, I receive it when I pray, and then, Father God, I thank you in advance.
Yes, Lord.
That they're already delivered.
Amen.
We're talking about today faith and entering the rest of God. Faith is entering the rest of God. It's entering the seventh day. Do you know that that'll take a lot of stress off your shoulders? David said, never have I seen the righteous forsaken. Now he said, this is what he's actually said. He said, once I was young, but now I'm old.
All right.
He said, never have I seen the righteous forsaken.
All right.
Nor his seed begging bread. Man, we are the seed of God. We should, amen. We don't supposed to be begging nothing. David said, man, he said, listen, I killed the bear. I slew a lion.
All right.
And I took the head of a giant. The same God. He said, who? And I know I'm jumping, but we're talking about faith. David, when David got it, man, got there to the mountain, they out there fighting. David said, who is this uncircumcised Philistine? That's defiling the armies of God. Who is this? David said, you come with a sword and a spear, but I come in the name of the Lord.
All right.
That's what we got to come in. We got to come and face the enemy in the name of the Lord. Yes. We got to know that our God is greater than whatever we're facing.
Yes, Lord.
But also, even though our God is greater, he's the head of the Most High God. God said, guess what? But I got to get y'all to rest.
All right.
Quit trying to do it yourself. John Doe, Joan is already delivered. Amen. Leave her alone. Go on about you. Act like she's already delivered.
Right.
Instead of going home worried, I wonder how she's doing. Oh, God. Leave her alone and let Jesus have her. It ain't your job to do it. I feel like I'm going to tell you this morning. Leave her alone and let Jesus have her. Because if you try to do it, all you're going to do is make it worse. Because all you're going to do is pacify her and give her what she don't need. And that's self-pity. She needs truth.
Amen.
Amen. Some people need truth in order to be set free. We spend too much time patting them on the shirt. Oh, the Lord come deliver you. No, just leave it in the hands of God. God will deal. And that's one thing about it. If God has given it to you, and if you pray for it and believe it, then God is going to deliver. Because man, he, the Bible said he in tune to the prayers of the righteous. So when I pray, I got to believe that I receive it when I pray. And then I walk around like I already have. Faith is having confidence. Faith is knowing. Faith is not guessing and trying to figure it out. Faith is knowing that my God hears me. You know, we walk around too often with low self-esteem, lack of confidence, and our character and personality reflects what we're going through too often.
Yeah, you're right.
That's not faith. If you really, the characteristics of faith is this, it's confidence. Rejoicing. That's why I said we shouldn't be depressed because we know our God hears us. We shouldn't be sad. Because we know our God hears us, we ought to have an attitude of confidence, an attitude of faith, an attitude of rejoicing, an attitude of praise, regardless of what we go through in life. Because we know that our God hears us. And he's Jehovah Rapha. He's the Lord that healeth.
Amen.
He's Jehovah Nisha. He's our victory. He's our banner. Church, we ought to have confidence. Act like they already delivered. When you see your sons, you ought to shake their hands and see your daughters. You ought to look at them and say, God bless you. I love you. Amen. Amen. And treat them like they already delivered.
Amen.
See, because faith sees everything already finished.
Amen.
Scripture said, but where there is no vision, the people perish. Faith carries vision. Faith has eyes, brother. Faith has vision. Faith vision is I see what God sees. I see it already changed. I see it already healed. I see it already delivered. In eternity, everything is finished. In the realm of faith, everything is already finished. I just got to receive it and believe it before it can manifest. We said this last week how that in Deuteronomy, I think Deuteronomy 8 and 2 talk about how that God took the children of Israel through the wilderness to test them to see what was in their heart, to see whether they keep his commandments and obey him. Sometimes God will take you through